All right, so now we're ready to talk about the crisis of 2008. And I think people are going to argue about sort of the causes and how the crisis of 2008 unfolded. They're going to argue about that for years. I'm going to maybe talk about a few of the narratives. I'll emphasize the one that I prefer. And the one that I prefer is actually the one that takes, you know, what came out of the SNL crisis, that is, belief in securitization, mark-to-market accounting, and risk-based capital, and all of those helped contribute to, they didn't necessarily cause, the crisis of 2008. That is, they all kind of made it worse. First of all, securitization, the thinking was that securitization kind of got rid of the interest rate risk in mortgages, because, you know, the savings and loans basically had failed because of interest rate risk. They were borrowing with short-term deposits that had regulated interest rates, and they were lending these long-term mortgages. So the idea is that somehow the capital markets would take care of interest rate risk. Interest rate risk. That was the thinking. The regulators definitely favored securitization, and that risk-based capital would take care would ensure prudent banking. That is, if you told banks that they would have to hold more capital against risky assets, they would select less risky assets. And finally, the mark-to-market was to try to protect regulators from not being able to close a bank or savings and loan because the bank is solvent on historical cost basis, even though it's truly insolvent. So these seem to be good solutions. They all came to be problems. The risk-based capital, ultimately, the low-risk assets under risk-based capital came to include Freddie and Fannie securities, so that allowed them to expand, and AAA-rated private label securities, and that allowed the subprime market to expand. So we had this explosion in mortgage credit from the 90s to 2000. So we have a big increase in mortgage credit, and it expands to, and the subprime market in particular really expands, and that's due in part to the innovation of being able to put subprime mortgages into these AAA-rated private label securities. Okay, so you so we have this So we have the combination of risk-based capital and securitization, and that pushes things forward. In the middle of the crisis, the mark-to-market accounting turned out to be very pro-cyclical. That is, you could as long as the securities are doing well, the market can expand. People are showing good amounts of capital on their books. and so people can and so things are good. And then when the market starts to turn the other way, then the companies that have these securities on their books have to sell them, and that in turn drives down the market value, and that in turn, because of the risk-based capital regulations and the mark-to-market accounting, means that people have to then reduce their holdings of the securities, which drives down the market value more, and you get this kind of vicious cycle of declining values. And that was really kind of in the middle of things in 2008, that that was what really caused a lot of problems. So mark-to-market accounting was not the regulator's friend during the at the kind of the height of the crisis, so to speak. So so these three policies that were introduced to kind of prevent a rerun of the savings and loan crisis, and were all somewhat dysfunctional in terms of what happened in 2008. Okay, so we get, so there's that. Now the policy response was sort of interesting. The policy response, I think, was based on a narrative, and I'm talking about, you know, the Dodd-Frank legislation as an example of the policy response, was based on a narrative that said, first of all, that one of the problems was an outbreak of predatory lending, kind of excess greed, and the we needed a consumer financial protection board. I should be a little bit careful about that, because a lot of the push for to lend to people who we now believe were not qualified to have mortgages, well, there was a lot of actual pressure from Congress and from the politicians to broaden the lending base, to lend to more people, increase home ownership, and so on. And there was some formal regulatory pressure in the form of the community lending requirement, CRA, and the also some affordable housing goals for Freddie Mac and Fannie Mae. Now, there's a lot of controversy over what the effect of those was and whether private firms would have gone after that market anyway, but in any case, there was certainly no pressure as the housing bubble was inflating. There was no political pressure being placed on anyone to curb their lending. and then another part of the narrative is that a lot of this, that regulators couldn't see the problems coming. They were building up in parts of the financial system that weren't being closely watched. The notion is that regulators going forward will be watching more carefully the risk. Although, as what we've seen is that the regulators at the time thought that they were watching risk and had it under control. They just thought that getting securities out in the capital markets and getting the mortgage loans off the books of the banks was kind of sufficient to manage risk from a regulatory standpoint. So it was kind of a, it wasn't that they weren't trying to manage risk, it's just they weren't kind of looking in the right places. So the main lesson I want you to take away from these talks is that if you just look backwards, you can be convinced that you are that you're solving a problem. That is, we thought we'd solve the problem of the Great Depression. Ultimately, that built up into the problems that created the savings and loan crisis. And then the things that we thought solved the savings and loan crisis contributed to, in fact, may have even caused the crisis of 2008. So you have to be a little worried that about a notion, and again, the narrative of Dodd-Frank is that somehow we can prevent ever having a bailout event, prevent having this kind of a crisis. And I think the evidence that, you know, if you look at from a long-term perspective, the evidence that we can, through regulation or smarter policies, prevent these things is not good. And it's something that I would worry about. I would be more inclined to try to have a financial system that's easier to fix rather than claiming that you can make it hard to break or impossible to have a crisis. So anyway, that's my story on the crisis of 2008.